Tonight, a special edition of Up Close with Patsy Smullin.
I never won any Emmys on the Today Show.
Two of the most watched personalities on television today.
I walked into the television station, and while I was bussing tables at a local restaurant, and said I wanted to get involved in this business, and they kind of looked at me like I was crazy.
He's an Emmy Award-winning reporter and national news magazine anchor.
We are constantly putting bad news on the air, and that's part of the nature of the animal. We're going to do that.
Dateline NBC's Stone Phillips.
I have suffered with this name my whole life.
And his Dateline co-host and former longtime anchor of the Today Show, the veteran NBC anchor and reporter, Jane Pauley.
Anchor men and women sitting side by side each other in every television market in America, local all the way up to network, has just trained people to expect to see women in professional positions in all walks of life.
Both the stars of Dateline NBC on this edition of Up Close with Patsy Smullin.
Hi, I'm Patsy Smullin. Dateline NBC is a program that has set the gold standard for television news magazines. NBC hit it big with Dateline, so big, in fact, that the network has expanded the show to an unprecedented five nights a week. Combine that with consistently high ratings, and you have a program that offers an incredible amount of viewership for its principal anchors, Jane Pauley and Stone Phillips. I had the opportunity to sit down and talk with Jane and Stone recently, and found them to be very open, honest, smart, and thoughtful individuals. Before coming to NBC News in 1976, Jane Pauley became the first woman to co-anchor a weeknight news broadcast in Chicago at WMAQ-TV. She started her career at NBC as co-host of The Today Show, a position she held for more than 13 years before finally saying goodbye to pursue other interests for the network. She anchored Real Life with Jane Pauley starting in 1991 and hosted numerous network documentaries. Over the years, she has reported from all over the world on everyone from the Pope to Prince Charles and Lady Di, all that and a husband and three children, twins included. This is the second time I've interviewed Jane, and we were both surprised at how much time had slipped by since we last talked.
Jane, when I last interviewed you, you were just leaving as anchor of the Today Show after 13 years, and you were so excited about getting some sleep. Now, it looks like you're working even more hours and you never look tired.
Oh, well, I get sleep. I think my training on the Today Show inspires me to go to bed early. And now I watch the Today Show, but it's with a cup of coffee in my pajamas. Life is better. But that's been a long time. Do you realize that's been 10 years?
Yes. Yeah. It's been a very long time.
1989. It's hard for me to believe that.
Dateline, the number one magazine television show. Incredibly successful. How is it different for you, this life, as opposed to the Today Show life, other than the middle of the night stuff?
It's just completely different. It simply is completely different. More time is spent on a story. I have the luxury, if I was sitting interviewing you for Dateline, I would have notes on my lap. We would talk for an hour or 2 hours or more. We would have the luxury of taking that interview and then shaping it into a story and telling the story and writing the story was unknown to me on the Today Show. I would have interviewed you. We would have just met moments before. And after about 5 or 6 minutes, you'd be gone. And that would be our total experience.
I know some of the highlights in the years with the Today Show, certainly the visit with the Pope, the wall, China, the London for the weddings of Prince Charles and Prince Andrew. What have been some of the highlights for you with Dateline?
I never won any Emmys on the Today Show. I have stories. With the Today Show, it was events. Recently, I was where in the world is Matt Lauer? And boom, there he was on the Great Wall of China. And my first reaction was, wow. My next reaction was, been there, done that. We did get to travel a lot, and at the end of a 2-hour live show, it really was exciting. But there wasn't necessarily something that you had shaped and worked and then said, okay, it's done, here it is. On Dateline, you do get to do that. You know, there are stories you look back on that everything about it felt you know, just right, and care was taken, and words carefully chosen, and pictures just right, and the effect of a story on an audience was exactly as you'd hoped, and maybe it made some kind of a difference to somebody. I wouldn't cite one story in particular, but I do love that aspect of the job the most. The most.
Coming up, more reflections from Jane Pauley.
That Jane, she looks really ridiculous out there swinging in a club, and I hope she doesn't really think she's a golfer, because she's not, but she's a good sport, and you go, girl.
As we look at this last year from Monica to Milosevic, in the blink of an eye, has this been one of the most difficult news years that you've covered?
You know, just the last some weeks have been extraordinary. You know, the Monica episode was stretched out over a year. I mean, that was slow motion torture in a way. Compared to you know, the experience the stories I've cited have put a strain on the whole country, not to mention the news divisions covering it.
How has life changed for the female in this business?
Oh, it's just dramatically. I think part of and it's not just women in this business, but I think one of the, it's hard to predict causality, but it's possible that the presence of anchor men and women sitting side by side each other in every television market in America, local all the way up to network, has just trained people to expect to see women in you know, professional positions in all walks of life. It's just not a shock anymore to my children's generation. They take that absolutely for granted, that there are women at every level. In Hollywood, there are, you know, women are presidents of major film studios. There just isn't any going back. That door has been closed, the go back door. Now, it doesn't mean that there are elements where women may find that glass ceiling that we speak of, but even the glass ceilings, you know, have trap doors you can get through. It's all in all, I'm tremendously amazed at how the world my daughter will grow up into, that she can take for granted things that never occurred to me that she would be able to, looking back 20 years ago. I thought it was going to be an uphill struggle, and for some women it was, but, you know, in a way, the barriers kind of collapsed. They just collapsed.
Golf with Bill Murray.
Fun. I've played golf with Bill Murray now twice. I made my golf debut, I swung a golf club, literally, not counting miniature golf and the putt-putt thing. You know. I swung a golf for the first time about 8 years ago with three cameras on me. Am I a good sport or what? I'm also an idiot. I had no idea. I never really played golf again for some years after that. And I took it up a couple of years ago. I'm terrible. Don't play often enough to get good. And here I am playing again with Bill Murray on television. Now, what's wrong with me? I guess I must assume that people are essentially generous, and they'll understand, and they'll say, that Jane, she looks really ridiculous out there swinging in a club, and I hope she doesn't really think she's a golfer, because she's not, but she's a good sport, and you go, girl. Because there I was again. Not all that much better. And nobody, no woman looks good in golf clothes. That's my concern.
They're not
about
the best.
Yes, there's really nothing attractive about golf outfits. But there I am. I really like it. I really like it. It's something that you do only on a pretty day with people you like. What's wrong with that?
I know that your father kept you very grounded because you told me lots of stories about that. How do you draw the line between reporter, journalist, and TV star?
I left one family that kept me grounded, and I now have another one, I assure you. There was a funny commercial this morning about something, I'm dropping a name, and I probably shouldn't do this, but called Celebrity Cruises or something like that. And my son says, oh, Mom, that's for you. And I assure you, this was sarcasm. The Celebrity Cruise for me, that's what I get at home. That's what I always have had. So it would be very hard for me to seriously think of myself as a star and last for more than half a day in my environment at home.
What is a typical work day for you now?
Well, gosh, there really isn't much of a typical one, I guess, but it tends to start. I have the coffee with the pajamas and the Today Show, and I go immediately at about 8 o'clock into my home office with a computer, and can start work, a couple hours of work there. I like that part of the day. For one thing, I'm still in my pajamas, and I still have my second cup of coffee, and it's quiet, and you can do think work and really feel like you're getting a lot done. Then, because Dateline is always on the air, I do spend an awful lot of time in this studio, so I'll come in and we'll do the makeup and, you know, getting ready and taping a show or two. Sometimes I tape, as I did today, for MSNBC Time and Again, which I do quite a lot of, too. And then there will be the unusual. I spent a week in Germany recently, chasing after a story. Travel might be an overnight out to Oregon or something on a story. It might be spent on telephones, trying to persuade someone why they want to tell Dateline their story and not someone else. And then the day is done, and I'm blessed that most of the time I can be home for dinner, and which is kind of unusual for family life in America today. I always have to qualify that. We don't eat very well. there isn't a real serious cook in my family. But whatever it is, we sit down and have it together because there's always a computer at the home office. And if necessary, I can come back in. But it's a pretty civilized life. I have no complaints.
Any final word for our viewers in Oregon and Northern California?
Well, I just am grateful that they are with us. And I hope they are repeatedly and regularly, because we'll be here when they come around.
You are the nicest person I have ever met in this business.
You told me I wrote you a thank you,
you
after our last interview. I have to confess, I was surprised.
You're the only one who has ever done that. Thank you so much, Jane.
Thank you, Patsy, again.
Up next, Stone Phillips talks about one of his favorite interview subjects.
She actually helped us set the lighting in her kitchen so that it would be the best. This is a woman who knows good light when she sees it.
If you watch programming made by NBC News, chances are you've seen plenty of Stone Phillips. Aside from his regular gig as Dateline co-anchor, he also serves as substitute moderator on Meet the Press. Stone has reported from virtually every corner of the globe and has received numerous awards for his work, including 2 Emmys. After countless intriguing and fascinating interviews over the years with everyone from Hollywood stars to politicians to fellow journalists, which one really stands out? We'll let Stone answer that.
Stone, first question, Sophia Loren.
That's a great place to start. That's a great place to finish, whatever. A wonderful interview. Went to Geneva at her home. She was incredibly gracious, opening her doors and allowing us to traipse in with our camera crews. Of course, she's no stranger to camera crews and lights, and she actually helped us set the lighting in her kitchen so that it would be the best. This is a woman who knows good light when she sees it, and yet she doesn't need it. She, at age 64, looks fabulous. She was remarkable in the interview, and as we were getting ready to do some of our shooting, we're standing next to each other, and she kind of looks at me and sort of straightens my shirt there a little bit and picks a little piece of lint off my cheek. And I'm thinking, wow, is this real? Sophia Loren and Frank Sinatra, Cary Grant, John Wayne, Stone Phillips.
Wow.
It was great.
I talked to a gentleman, Ron, who said he was your first boss, your first job after college. And he said He knew immediately that you would be tremendously successful because you were quick on your feet, passionate about news, and a hard worker and high energy.
You know, everyone should be blessed to begin in this business in a shop as good as WXIA was at that point. This was the then ABC affiliate in Atlanta. I had gotten out of Yale with a philosophy degree, having no idea what I was going to do with it. And actually went to Atlanta working on a grant program teaching remedial reading and math to inner city kids through the Fulton County Juvenile Court. And when that grant expired, I walked into the television station, and while I was bussing tables at a local restaurant, and said I wanted to get involved in this business, and they kind of looked at me like I was crazy and told me I needed to go to a smaller market. And I said that that I wanted to start there. I wanted to start in Atlanta. And eventually they gave me a shot. And so I started there, and under the guidance of people like Ron Becker, whom you mentioned, and Dick Williams, who were sticklers for writing and accuracy and ran a very tight newsroom, was able to get off to a really good start in this business, and I'm very grateful to those people.
At what age did you know this is what you wanted to do?
Probably then. Maybe not even then. I was a philosophy major. I didn't really know what I wanted to do when I went to college. If you'd asked me then, I probably would have said teaching, education. My mother was a teacher. I came from a family of teachers on my mother's side, and probably gravitated toward that. But once I got started in this business, it's so engaging because every day is another story, and it's important. The public service aspect of it appealed to me, and that hasn't changed all these years.
You told us that the story that's impacted you the most over these many years was Littleton.
An unbelievable tragedy. I spent a week in Littleton after the shootings at Columbine High talking to parents and teachers and administrators and police officers. And the brutality of the act was just so astounding. The cruelty of it was so gripping. And people there were so devastated that it was as hard as any story I've ever covered emotionally. I felt really depressed coming home. I've been struggling with those feelings ever since.
You told us that you came home from that, and your son said one night, "Dad, am I safe at school?" You didn't tell us how you responded.
Well, I tried to reassure him. He's 11 years old, he's in middle school, his school had been evacuated, there had been a threat, someone had left a note in a desk saying he was going to blow up the school. Police come, and this is a quiet, you know, suburban setting, these things aren't supposed to happen, you always hear that, and yet it did, and the police came in, searched the school, the kid was taken into custody and questioned, his parents were called in, and Streeter said, you know, sometimes I feel like sometimes the only place I feel safe is in bed. And I tried to reassure him that it was important for the police to respond to this and to investigate this, but it was a prank, and that he should feel safe because they just can't grow up feeling paranoid about these things. And yet it's increasingly difficult for us as parents to know what to tell them. I'm sure, you know, parents at Columbine High were telling their kids the same thing. It's hard to believe it, but we've got to believe it, and you reassure them, and at the same time, you have to inject some element of reality, and that's where we stand right now, unfortunately.
You also said, what good does it do to wire the world if we short-circuit our souls? Can television news help our situation in America?
I think it can. I think we can, do a better job of pointing the way to solutions. You know, what you hear and what you feel all the time is that we are constantly putting bad news on the air. And that's part of the nature of the animal. We're going to do that because that's the way it is. And that's the way it should be. I mean, we should be finding problems and reporting on them so that we can improve them. But I also think we have to find ways to stop feeding the cynicism that's developing. And youth violence is a perfect example. We can throw our hands up and say it's incomprehensible and hopeless, or we can say, what are we going to do about it? My hat's off to the president for convening this group of people, of industry experts and child violence experts at the White House to try to get something done, but we're going to have to do a lot more than talk about it. And I think from a television news standpoint, putting informed, intelligent people with ideas on the air, and we've done that on Dateline, psychologists talking about how do we spot these kids, how do we help them, understanding the connection between suicide and homicide in every one of these cases, Paducah and Springfield and Columbine, these kids are suicidal first and homicidal second. And unfortunately, they want to take other people down with them as they go. But we've got to start looking at the roots and coming up with some understanding. So television news plays a role there.
Coming up, Stone talks about more memorable interviews.
He comes across as kind of a geek, as a nerd, nerdish kind of guy, and yet there is a lot of aggression in him.
You mentioned in your childhood seeing your dad's eyes and listening to his voice when he spoke of watching the Ku Klux Klan go by in Texas, mm-hmm. and the fear. And what kind of an impact did he have on you?
Well, my father is, he's a disabled war veteran. His right arm was paralyzed in Belgium in 1945. And I guess like any father and son, he's had a huge impact on me in a lot of different ways. He is by nature incredibly shy, and his injury, I think in many ways only compounded that. But I look up to my father. I think when I told the story about him telling me about seeing the Klan, it's just when you see the emotions of the revulsion he felt and the fear he felt in telling that story, it's always striking to see that in a parent's eye, because our tendency is to see parents as, you know, bigger than life. Mm-hmm. And when parents share their fears, it's always striking and you remember it.
Bernie Goetz, your interview. Tell us about that.
Really interesting interview. Bernie Goetz, the subway gunman of New York, who shot several of his fellow passengers after he felt threatened by them. Interesting fellow. Interesting to me because image and reality are two very different things with Bernie Goetz. He comes across as kind of a geek, but, as a nerd, nerdish kind of guy, and yet there is a lot of aggression in him. He brought his pet chinchilla to the interview here in New York, and he described his pet, the chinchilla, as a docile, gentle creature until cornered, and then it can become vicious. And it was interesting that he would describe his pet that way, because he was really describing himself. And Bernie Goetz is, I think, a wolf in sheep's clothing.
What do you wish Americans were thinking more about than they are?
I don't know. I think it's tough right now. I think it's tough for American families right now. People are working really hard. Parents are working really hard. Both parents are working. And I don't know. I'm not sure that I want people to think about anything. I feel like we should all be praying for a better balance in our lives, where mothers and fathers are able to spend more time with their children and with each other and recollect some of what was good about the 50s. We don't want to go back there, but more time together is something I know that I yearn for, and I think a lot of families do. We're all working so hard that I think a better balance would go a long way toward solving some of the issues we've talked about. Youth violence, being able to tune in more, slow down a little bit. I remember thinking back in the 70s when we had the gas crisis, if the gasoline crisis makes us all slow down a little bit, maybe it will have been a positive thing. And I think the same is true here. You know, we want to work hard, we want to be productive, but we've also got to find some way to make more time for ourselves and for our families.
Speaking of balance, will you come visit our viewers in Oregon and Northern California?
I'd love to. That's one of my favorite parts of the country.
Thank you, Stone.
Thanks, Patsy.
Very much.
Like no program before it or since, Dateline NBC continues to attract viewers and expand its coverage of events, issues, and stories, great and small. And no small part of that success has been the team that anchors the show in a way that appears almost effortless, yet requires a lot of hard work, research, and dedication. Stone Phillips and Jane Pauley are both intelligent, professional, engaging, and yes, they're truly nice people. I thoroughly enjoyed the time they spent with me, and I hope you enjoyed it too. Thank you for watching tonight's program. Until next time, good night.